if there is any stress level test in any organization based on the function, I think product would be like the most stressful function in an organization.
I agree a lot with that.
Hey everyone, this is Renuka.
I'm Shraddha.
Started my career as a software engineer. I've been working in tech for around 15 years now.
I'm a product manager at Fashion currently. Like Renuka, I also started as a software engineer in my career.
But why did you move away from software engineering into product management? Because I am a software engineer.
There's this saying that as a PM, you're the mini CEO. Which I actually truly believe in.
I don't agree on this because I have seen engineers earning more than product managers. So I was an electrical engineer and the things that I studied in my college are not coming in handy right now. It's mostly okay. Something that I learned again.
What is that one product management tool you hate?
It's Confluence.
Okay.
The success of the team is not dependent on just the product manager, but it's the PM, the designer, and the engineer.
How much people can make after having significant years of experience in product management?
Like 80 lakhs to go all the way till.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to season 2, episode 2 of the AirTribe podcast. In this episode, we have Renuka here, who held leadership positions at Simple and Shopify. And we have Shraddha, who is a PM at Atlassian. Renuka and Shraddha, why don't you introduce yourself and we'll get started.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much for having me here. Hey everyone, this is Renuka. I started my career as a software engineer. I've been working in tech for around 15 years now. I worked with various startups ranging from pre-seed to Series D, E. And most recently, I was working with Simple. And other than startup and Simple, I worked with large companies like Shopify and Philips. Okay. And yeah, excited to be here.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming.
All right. Hey, everyone. I'm Shraddha. I am a product manager at Atlassian currently. Like Renuka, I also started as a software engineer in my career, had few years of experience there, went for an MBA and then stepped into product management role. So it's been 2 years for me as a product manager, so quite early there.
Before I get into any other question, I would really want to know that why did you move away from software engineering into product management? Because I am a software engineer, still an engineer. It's been almost 10 years for me now. So I would really love to know what was the trigger for you and why did you get into product management from software engineering?
So I moved to product management many years ago. And this was because during my time with Philips, I came across a product manager who was doing the product work.
Okay.
Where I saw that this person had a lot more context of the project that we were working on. Mm-hmm. This person was working with customers, understanding the market conditions and synthesizing all the information that was there and then coming up with a project. And from the project, we were sort of like taking up tasks and working on tasks.
Got it. And how did the transition happen for you from engineering to product management?
So for me, I moved into, so I was working with Philips back in the days and I had already spent 5 years with Philips and I wanted to move to a startup because I started my career. I spent though very little time with the startup, but startup is something where I like really enjoy working. One, I wanted to move into product management. Secondly, I wanted to work with startups. So that's when I made a move to a company where I worked as a product manager.
Got it. Okay. Shraddha, what about you? Why did you leave your engineering job? And
So I think after 2 years of my engineering role, I realized that I need to go into management because this job of sitting and coding is not made for me. Mostly because after a point of time, it was like I'm not really using a lot of my creativity. I'm being handed okay. down tasks and I just need to do it. So I then made a switch to Expedia, which is a very product first company. Yeah. And there I interacted with product manager. And luckily, the product manager at that time was also quite new in her career. So, got a lot of interactions with her. And I liked the way she used to operate because she used to take a lot of inputs from us as engineers. But we were also the users of the product, right? So, it made a lot of sense. And the way I talked to her and a lot of role that she explained about, you know, collaborating everyone, leading the product, defining the destination or the fate of that product as a product manager. So that was something which aligned to me, but I was not completely sure until then, until I moved to my MBA, and there I had a lot of opportunities to explore, like in finance or investment banking, but none of that really struck a chord with me. And I realized that I want to be still a part of technology, and that's the reason I thought like product management role fits well for me that way. And so I like after graduating from my MBA, I directly went to a product manager role.
Okay, got it. A lot of people who are not product managers and they are looking at product managers from their own lens, they don't, like sometimes they feel that, okay, this is an easy job, like because they don't code, they don't design, they don't take marketing thing on their own, they don't do sales. And a lot of them have this perception that this is probably a very cozy or easy job to be in, and obviously it pays well. But what are your thoughts? I'm sure that that's not correct, but how would you explain them the role of a product manager?
Yeah, it's definitely not easy. I think if we were to test like the stress, like if there is any stress level test in any organization based on the function, I think product would be like the most stressful function in an organization.
I agree a lot with that.
But everyone will say that, right? I mean, you ask software engineer, they will say, you ask sales team, they will say that, okay, our job is most stressful.
I think, I mean, I don't deny that it's not stressful for other functions. But as a product manager, you're sort of, I know there's, you know, there's this saying that as a PM, you're the mini CEO, which I actually truly believe in. Like, I think you are, because when you're building a product, right, you are sort of like, you're running the show. You are the CEO of that product that you're building. Okay. Now you have to work with different stakeholders. In many cases, you have to influence stakeholders without any authority. Like if let's say, you know, when I started my career as a PM, I was working with the engineers, like, you know, who were like, you know, who were on the director level while I was on the PM level, right? And then they are very senior folks, and similarly design and other folks. One is when you come up when you work on a product or on a project, you have to get approvals from the leadership. That's number one, right? So then you have to, like, you know, do all the homework and work with various stakeholders to make sure that you're putting together a proposal that's attractive, where you can get buy-in from the leadership.
Okay.
And once you have the buy-in, the story doesn't end there. Then you have to work with all the stakeholders who are, like, you know, your engineering stakeholder, your design stakeholders, or could be, you know, the sales and like more support and other functions. And even in those cases, there is a lot of convincing that's needed, where you need to, because you are the owner of the product, you need to convince the sales team to be able to sell the product even before the product is built, right? You need to convince the, you know, support team to be able to allocate resources for your product, right?
Okay.
It doesn't just come out of the box, right? It's not like everything is like served on the plate. And I'm not denying that for other functions, everything is served on the plate, but still other functions are very clearly defined, right?
Okay.
As a software engineer, you have your own technical skill set and you work on it.
Mm-hmm.
As a designer, these are the things that you work on it. And there are very clear boundaries also defined, right? Even as a salesperson, there is a very clear boundary defined.
Correct.
But when it comes to product management, there are no boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
Forget about defining it. There are no boundaries. You have to, there are times you have to, you know, put like wireframes together, like, you know, which is in some organizations, it's the designer that does it, right? You have to conduct interviews. In some cases, it's the researcher that does it, right? I think in some cases, maybe there are product managers who are sitting and coding as well.
Yeah.
But like you have to sell the product. You have to, like, you know, provide the customer support. So there are like, you have to be very adaptable to be able to adapt into like all of these roles. I think, and then, like, you know, act as the owner of the product that you are building. So I think those are the reasons I would say why this job is like more stressful.
Makes sense. Okay. A lot of aspiring product managers, which I talk to, they believe that a lot of companies are also looking for tech background as well. Like if you come from a BTech or if you are already an engineer and then that get into product management, it's easier. And then I do believe that that's true. That becomes easier for engineers to transition into product management because of their tech background. But how important or critical or necessary it is to have that kind of background? Like a lot of people have that anxiety that, hey, if I don't have that background, I'm going to be at a huge disadvantage and it's going to be pretty much impossible for me to transition.
I don't think you need a technical background. It's not a necessity or mandatory thing. I have a lot of colleagues who are from various backgrounds like marketing, designing, biomedicine, analysts, and they are doing really well. So my skip level manager was in sales and marketing before, and he's a group product manager right now. And I've seen people who are designers and they have accelerated in their product manager role very fast, even without a technical background.
Got it. But that's something can be learned on the job, right? I mean, or maybe some with some resources or something. It doesn't really require a full-fledged degree as such in software engineering.
It's basic knowledge. So I was an electrical engineer and I'm working on software, which, so my knowledge are the things that I studied in my college are not coming in handy right now. It's mostly something that I learned again by myself.
Now, let's also address the money part, right? A lot of people feel that being a product manager is a very lucrative job. And specifically in the last couple of years, a lot of people want to get into product management. And this has been one of the most critical thing for them, that, okay, this job pays well, which is true. But I want to know, like, how much people should expect when they're just starting their career as a product manager? What's the range they should expect? And maybe you can also share, Renuka, that how much people can make after having significant years of experience in product management, where they can, what's the range they can expect as a PM?
So I think one is that it is a myth that you're going to earn a lot, especially in the early years of your career. I have seen engineers earning more than product managers. But at the same time, when you start early in your career, it's almost the same as engineers. It's around 15 to 30 lakhs or 15 to 40 lakhs. So it depends upon which company you're working for, which startup you're working for. So that's generally the range. And as you progress, it increases. But yeah, that's how it is. I don't know. Probably like Renuka can tell about the leadership part. Because I don't want to guess there. But yeah, that's for early career, it's around 15 to 30 or 40.
Okay.
I would say when you are starting early, you shouldn't care about money. You should not even think if you're getting 15,000 versus 15 whatever lakhs.
Getting in is very important.
Yeah, exactly. Getting in is important. Getting into the right company, getting into the right place, getting to work with the right set of people is more important, right? But on Shraddha's point, the product and engineer, they sort of like earn in a, again, it depends on the company. In some companies, they might have a higher range for engineers or higher range for products, but the earning is around the same. But in the later stages, when you become like a principal PM, again, I think it depends on the companies, but you can earn somewhere between 50 lakhs to go all the way to 1 crore, depending on the company that you're joining. And once you move into leadership role, then it can, range from 80 lakhs to go all the way till 2 crore. There are people who have their cash component is 2.5 crores and so on, nowadays. Yeah. So, it does matter. But then and I'm 100% sure people who are getting that kind of salary, they did not think about money in the early days of their career. Sure. They thought about, learning. They thought about working with people where they can learn from. And that's why they are there where they are right now.
What do you think? Is AI going to take PM jobs anytime soon? How far we are in that journey, or is it going to happen or not? What are your views there?
I think for product managers, it's not going to happen. AI cannot replace a product manager. It's going to make their lives easier. It's basically a tool to make them more efficient or productive, but it cannot definitely replace a product manager's role, because that role requires a lot of skills which are human based. You need to understand team dynamics. You need to have that emotional intelligence. You need to have customer empathy. You need to understand how to collaborate different teams to work on the same goal. That AI cannot do. AI can help you drive that faster, but you still need a human because you are working with other humans. So that is not possible because unless AI gets that
AGI level,
if it gets a sentinel view, it can't replace a product management role. Might reduce the number of PMs we have, but I still don't feel that's going to be possible because a lot of decision making judgment that's required as a product manager, AI is still not capable of doing that.
Now we're going to start with our next segment, which is rapid fire round. In this round, I'm going to ask one question each, and you can answer it in one word or maybe in one sentence, but keep it short unless there is an explanation required. If there is, then please go ahead and do that. First question is very, very interesting. I'll start with you. What is it one product management tool you hate, which is not Jira? No offense.
I think if it's not Jira, it's Confluence.
Okay.
So the reason for that is when I use Confluence, I feel like it sort of like puts in a lot of boundaries and it wants me to start the, you know, the first sentence with the structure. Mm-hmm. So usually for writing, I use a pyramid approach where you sort of like start like, you know, putting like dump all your thoughts on paper and then you sort of like refine it. And then it's sort of like, you know, like whatever, like it becomes like this pyramid, like you start
with
like,
to build up.
And it becomes like structure, eventually it becomes structured. But when I use Confluence, I feel like it's just like pushing me to be structured from the first like sentence itself. So that's probably the reason. I use Google Docs over Confluence.
Okay. You want to defend any one of them?
Yeah, totally. I mean, I don't agree on this because I start a lot of my documents on Confluence and then refine it because it provides a good iteration, like you can update it all the time, you can collaborate on it, and it maintains that history as well, so you can go back to that previous history and do it. So I think it's more about the mentality you have been using it with, probably like in the places you have been working on where you are required to present it as a structured approach, and which is why your probably mind has associated that with starting with a structure. I completely use Confluence even for my drafts or notes. And then we can refine it later and share it. You can save it as a draft. You can lock it down for yourself if you don't want others to view that version. So it has all those capabilities. I think it's more about the mental model here.
Okay, cool. Enough pitch for Jira, Confluence and Atlassian.
Give it a try.
But for you, what's that tool which you hate? I'm sure that's not Jira.
Yeah, definitely. It's Microsoft Teams.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, I have not used it as within this organization, but it was one of the tools we used during our college times, and it's super unreliable, bad performance. The calls will drop. It will not scale well if a lot of people join in. It hangs during the calls. It has a chat feature, but it doesn't have a lot of, features or flexibility to do a lot. So it restricts you a lot in doing that. We have better products. For example, Slack, instead of using Microsoft Teams. I mean, instead of using Microsoft Teams, Google Meet or even Zoom is much, much better.
Fair enough.
That product is very heavy, so it's going to stop other applications also on your PC. Stops the productivity.
Cool. Now, we'll keep it a little short for the upcoming questions. Who is your favorite PM role model?
I'll say Steve Jobs. I mean, he has been a visionary in his field. He's not just a role model for a lot of people. He's also a gold standard when you say in product management.
Okay. What about you, Renuka?
Yeah, I think other than Steve Jobs, definitely one. I would say Marty Gagan. He's like, you know, like his SVPG, the whole group, the articles that they have written, the way they visualize, you know, product management to product managers, to product leaders. The things that I learn from his writings, from his books, his videos, his lectures, and his, you know, articles is super, like, valuable and insightful. Yeah.
Okay. If you could swap your role with some other team member, who would that be?
I would say a product designer. Okay. Because that role has a more creative edge to it, where you can focus more on the creative part. They're involved in the discussions with customers, they're involved in the problem phase, they're involved in the exploration phase as well, without the hard parts of PM role, which is collaborating and
without worrying about other teams.
Yes, so it's
fair enough.
I'll say designer.
Okay, Renuka?
Yeah, I think with your boss, otherwise you're not doing your job well. But yeah, jokes apart, I believe of course with your boss, because they need to know everything that you're doing. And if you're not there, they should be able to operate on your level and, you know, the team should go on.
Okay, yeah. Got it. Which popular product is most likely to be relevant in coming years?
I think with the, you know, AI coming into, you know, in the market, and still I believe it's still in the early, you know, stages, it's going to improve over the period of time, with real time translation coming into, you know, picture, I would say Duolingo.
Acha, yeah. Okay, got it. Shraddha?
So I would say Grammarly, because now its use is becoming irrelevant with coming of AI.
Oh yes.
Yeah. A lot of the tasks that Grammarly does, correcting you, providing you suggestions on how to rewrite, it's already integrated in a lot of tools using AI. Mm. Confluence has it, Google has it, Gmail has it, WhatsApp also has it now. So a lot of that is already integrated, which makes Grammarly very redundant now.
Why do product managers love meetings so much?
I believe as a PM, you are in most meetings, you are either gaining context or sharing context. Like a large part of your job is gaining context or sharing context, right? Both of these only happen during meetings. Now, whatever you call meeting, if it's like, you know, 101, it could be like a, you know, water cooler discussion, or it could be an email, or so because your job depends on a lot of time gaining context or giving context to your stakeholders. So all of these two can only happen during the meeting. So that could be the reason why product managers not like love per se, but they prefer
have to do
product
it.
Meetings. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Shraddha and Renuka, any parting advice for our audience?
I would say like as a product manager, you should reach out to more and more people because we need to learn a lot from other product managers given this is a very new field.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of it is not recorded in books as such. And it's best to learn from people who have already made mistakes and already learned from them. And this has helped me a lot. I rely a lot on guidance and mentorship within my company as a whole as well. So I reach out to a lot of senior PMs who help me, fast track my performance and my growth and not get stuck on the same points which they did. So I would say be more free and more networking within your company or even outside.
Okay. Renuka, you want to quickly...
Yeah, I think like plus one to learning from others. Other than that, if you are a product manager, early stage product manager, or even experienced product manager, or even a product leader, whenever you are building something, you know, could be small, could be really large, understand the why behind it. Understand what are the objectives of doing this? Why does it exist? How does it help the company? How does it help the business? How does it help the business? Is the market? Understanding all aspects of the feature, the product you are building, and from there deriving what you want to do and how you want to do it.
Okay.
So I think the why, the what, and the how are super super critical. And you need to spend a lot of time on the why for you to be able to do the what and the how better.
Okay, so be more curious and understand what you are doing, why you're doing before getting started with that particular task.
And it's not like just one sentence why. Like it's not like it's adding value, it's adding revenue, or it's a new revenue stream. Mm-hmm. Understand like why is it a new revenue stream? Why this, right? Why would customers use this? Why would why is your business building this? Why not something else, right? So I think spending a lot of time on the why. That'll really help you spend less time and build better the what you are building and the how you want to build it.
Got it. Thank you so much. And with that, we come to the end of this episode. Thanks again, Renuka and Shraddha, for coming here, spending time with us and sharing your insights. And we'll see you in the next episode.